Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Play that.
Our meeting will now come to order, please. Ms. Vaughn has our invocation tonight.
Well, I took the opportunity to invite a very special guest, a television star and everything, Dr. Larry Covington from Ebenezer United Church of Christ. Thank you.
Good evening.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Let's pray together. God bless this county and those chosen to represent its welfare. Give wisdom, vision, knowledge, guidance, leadership, understanding. Grant us even prosperity as we seek to do your will in this county. May all that is done, debated, decided this night be in keeping with your will. In the name of our Christ, amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Mr. Covington.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay, the next thing is the public comments, and these are limited to 3 minutes per person. And I would, Mr. Hsu, you're on here first, so I'll let you talk.
Well, I'll try to talk fast.
Okay.
I have got into it with NC Geological Survey. Mm-hmm. I had been told at one point that one of the points was the old Mebane House in Mebane. After I pointed out to Dennis Lee that the old Mebane House in Mebane wasn't built until 10 years after the county line was run, he came back and said that they used the 9 mile point. Okay, I asked him where the 9 mile point was, and he said they did not put a location there. Now, I'm in the process of hiring my own surveyor to locate that point. I'm here to ask you to have somebody call them, because they're using that point, and have them mark that point so I don't have to go to this expense. I do not see, in other words, they said that was a point they used, yet they did not mark it, you know, like they did the other point.
Okay.
And so I would like, you know, get the county manager, county attorney, somebody to call them, tell them to mark it, because before
and
I have
to. That's Geodetic that you're talking about.
Yeah, okay. Dennis Lee is the one I talked to. And if they have the point already, it looks like they stick a stake there and save me this money.
Okay.
Thank you.
Mr. Allwright, can you take care of that?
I don't think the state has any money to do any more survey or whatever. I'll contact
them. Yeah, because he says they already have it marked.
He had the coordinates. He said it. He said he was going to send them to.
Okay.
I'll call him.
Okay. Thank you, Sam. Okay, the next one is Frankie Durham. Hey, Frankie.
Hey, how are y'all?
Good. How are you doing?
I'm Frankie Durham. I'm here to address the noise ordinance that you are proposing about the hunting dogs and dogs, or I guess dogs in general.
Now, you know, I'll let you go ahead and talk about it now because that is next on the agenda.
Okay, you want me to just wait on that then?
It don't matter. You can, or
I'll just wait on that.
Well, since we don't have anybody else signed up, but one more, Mr. James, Dr. Who is that? I can't read the writing. Yes.
James Hall.
Hall. Okay. Are you here about the same thing? Okay. Well, at this time then, since I don't have anybody else to talk in public comments, I will go ahead and let you speak on the. But first of all, let's let Jason, where are you?
Yeah, let Jason. Go.
Let's let Jason present it to us first.
That would be fine.
And then I will let you talk, okay?
Thank you very much.
Okay. Yeah, ready. You're rocking. Ready?
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. What you have in front of you tonight is a proposed noise ordinance, Alamance County Ordinance prohibiting unreasonably loud, disturbing, unnecessary noises. Included in your packets tonight are also a copy of the existing noise ordinance. I wanted to include that for you all to look at as well, along with this.
Is that the one that's got draft 710 at the top?
That is the new ordinance.
The new, okay. Where's the old?
The old one is at.
Is that the little two-page ordinance?
It's at the back of it.
Well, mine's at the front.
Or at the front.
Well, Alamance County noise ordinance.
It should be attached to the new ordinance, along with the memo.
Well, now this one.
Can you come here short to us?
Sure. I don't think I have one.
Okay.
Is this it, Jason? What's that one?
Yes, ma'am.
That's the old one.
That's the old one.
On the back, it's right here.
Just one page?
It's just one page.
It's on the very back.
Back of the first page and part of the second.
It's the back of the first page.
It doesn't have a title.
It doesn't have anything.
Okay.
Yeah, this has, yeah, it does, has Alamance County noise ordinance. But that's the old one. So the new one is the new one is the 5 or 6 page.
That's the draft.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am, and I apologize for the confusion on that.
Okay.
And also included in your ordinance, I'm going to address a few things tonight. You also should have had a copy of an email that was sent. I believe it came to Craig Honeycutt and was sent to me, and we included that in the packet from Dr. Rice with regards to the section about dogs.
Yes, sir.
And also, I just handed you another email that I received that dealt with motorcycles and dirt bikes that I had received on the 1st of September.
Okay.
Just to kind of briefly give a little bit of history on this, and I will try to keep my comments very brief tonight because I'm sure you all will have a lot of questions and there's people that want to speak.
Okay.
The ordinance was something that was approached to staff from the Sheriff's Department with regards to the new ordinance. There was some expression from them that the current ordinance was vague and basically unenforceable. And that was, staff was directed, and we took that to the planning board, the draft, and the planning board considered and recommended approval of what you have in front of you tonight. I have spoke with some of you who asked questions individually, and I believe I misspoke, so for the sake of clearing the air on something, I don't want to have misspoke to you. I believe I had said something about New Hanover County. Some of the ordinance was taken from New Hanover County, which is actually incorrect. I did look at New Hanover County. When this started, there was some discussion about looking at decibel levels and decimeters and things like that, and decibel meters, and looked at New Hanover County at that point. What you have in front of you is actually a lot of that was taken from Henderson County and also Rockingham County. They both had very similar ordinances, and that was tailored to try to match up Alamance with Alamance County's concerns. So.
Well, forgive me. I talked to you. You mentioned New Hanover. How do you?
Yes, sir.
How do you mess that up? You clearly told me explicitly, verbatim, that it was from New Hanover, and I made the comment to you that it was said that we had to go to another county to see what they were doing, especially New Hanover. Made the comment about it being a liberal county, a high tax county, so forth, so on, a high bureaucratic county, and so forth. And you made it clear it was New Hanover. You never mentioned the other two counties. How do we mess these things up?
And that it was I'll be honest with you, sir. It was an honest mistake. I made a mistake with what I said. I looked at a lot of different counties, not just those ones that I just talked about, but also Transylvania County and a few other places and a few towns as well. And I honestly got it mixed up. That was my mistake. It was the one I originally started looking at, and then there was some discussion about not focusing on decibel levels. So that's, I do want to apologize for that.
Well, forgive me, but, you know, these are important matters.
Mm-hmm.
And you're paid well. And we have a good staff of, numerically. I don't understand how these things don't register automatically when you talk to people. I'm surprised.
I do apologize.
Well, if you don't mind, let's go ahead and begin.
Well, I'm surprised. I know what the conversation was, and to hear this now is shocking to me that we have somebody in management that can't tell me the facts when I call them.
Okay. I feel as a mid-level manager that I also am obligated to correct when I'm wrong.
Okay.
So and I do apologize for that. And I hope you appreciate that I tried to do that. So.
Okay. Go ahead, Jason.
Okay. The ordinance, basically, I want to go over a lot of things that were addressed to me. I have received a ton of phone calls regarding this matter. Of course, the dogs was one section that I've had a lot of calls about. And that is on page 2 of the ordinance, under number 3, pets, and it says the keeping, owning, possessing, harboring, or controlling of any animal or bird which barks, bays, yelps, howls, cries, squawks, or makes any other unreasonably loud, disturbing noise continuously or incessantly for a period of 10 minutes or intermittently for a period of 30 minutes or more, thereby causing a noise disturbance. I've also, as you know, in the packets, you've received an email with a recommendation to change that to a period of 3 minutes incessantly, or 10 minutes or more, or 5 minutes or more, I believe it was, thereby causing a noise violation. That was one recommendation. I've also had others express concerns that they should not be regulated at all, that this is something, being that you live in the country, it's a byproduct of living in the country that dogs bark. And so just presenting both sides there, I have had both present. The other item that we've received a lot of comments about was for clarification regarding the exemption for bona fide farming. And actually just this morning I took a phone call at great length discussing that very matter. The original ordinance exempts farming operations, which was the goal of the current ordinance, was to maintain that exemption and not to have something that attacks farmers. And so it has been suggested that that be stricken from the ordinance, that the words bona fide be taken out. We have also had some concerns expressed at the planning board. There was a great deal of discussion with regards to on page 4, exemption number 14 or exception number 14, normal sounds associated with or customary to industrial or manufacturing operations in the normal course of business, provided that said businesses are operating in a lawful manner. There has been a lot of discussions about this ordinance not applying to commercial operations or industrial operations. And staff has taken a stance with the planning board at that meeting, and it's also the planning board's stance after that meeting that noises that are customary to commercial or industrial operations should be exempt. But there has been concerns presented from the public to the contrary, to say that we should make this ordinance apply to commercial operations. There's also one other item with regards to the section 10 on page 5 with special event permits. The purpose behind that was not in any ordinance. That is actually something that was written into this ordinance. That was after a lot of discussion with the Sheriff's Department regarding this matter. The purpose of that was to acknowledge those circumstances where people may have weddings and they have live bands and things like that, and they may go beyond 11 o'clock at night with noise issues. And that's where there was the suggestion to put in a special event permit where they can do that. And that's to serve two purposes, really. One purpose, so that the Sheriff's Department knows that something's going on and they can convey that to people that are complaining. They can explain to them that, look, they've applied for a permit, this is a wedding, such and such has gotten married today, and if it goes beyond midnight, call us back. That was one purpose of that. And the other purpose of that was also to hopefully have the property owner, you know, engage their neighbors as well when they have these kinds of things come up. So that was a suggestion that was put in here. It has been suggested that there be a time limit placed on or applicability time of midnight on weekends for Fridays and Saturdays with the ordinance as opposed to 11 o'clock, so that would cover that. And that was kind of the purpose of the special event permit, was to deal with those private parties and things like that. I really wanted to just kind of spend some time talking about the questions that we've had raised. And I'll be glad to take any questions you all have at this time.
Okay, we'll start then. Kim, you want
to? I'm still pondering a couple of things. Go ahead.
Eddie, you got questions on it?
Well, I know in working through this with Jason and them, a lot of it was because Major Britt was at several of the meetings we had talking about it. And a big problem was the fact that they had nothing for enforceability. They'd spent a lot of time going out trying to resolve disturbance issues between people and had nothing with any teeth in it to work with. And I think that was really what we started out looking at when we started doing this, is to put some kind of enforcement behind it where it would actually work. Some of the things in here, and like the bona fide farming operations, I'm sure some of those things we need to talk about and work through. And that's why when Jason and the planning board worked through it, they realized going through it that it's up to us to make that decision
right
here on this board. So hopefully we'll have some more voices on it and can come out with something that works.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I had some calls. Some people were pretty put out about the special event permits and having outside music and parties and so forth. And they've just felt like, are we getting into an arena where there's too much government involvement in our daily lives? Which I really kind of agree with. But I don't know what kind of, Tim, Terry, I don't know what kind of complaints that you guys have had. I'm not privy to that information.
He's going to tell us in a minute.
Yeah.
He's going to tell us. So I'll let him talk.
But I just mentioned that.
Yeah.
I think by and large, and Major Britt and Sheriff Johnson can speak to this more, but by and large, their complaints they get are regarding music and noise. And I think there's also been a lot of calls about recreational vehicles and things like that. But by and large, it's music.
The only one I know about is the firecrackers. And we've settled that one. It was about a year or 2 years ago, and the neighborhood did not know there were firecrackers going off at this wedding or at the reception. So that's been handled. But I didn't know.
And in defense of the Sheriff's Department, what they've come to me with regarding this is they wanted guidance for the officers, some clear-cut guidelines, as opposed to something that was very vague in the original ordinance, where they felt like it was very vague, something that tends to annoy or disturb or frighten a citizen, things like that. They wanted some clearer guidelines, and that was what the goal was with this ordinance, was to kind of give more guidelines more than anything, and take some of the subjectivity out.
Most of the calls that I've got, or the only calls that I've got, there's only three, and that was about loud music. I haven't received any calls on barking dogs or anything else, but it's music.
Well, can we go back to the dog situation?
Let's see what Tim's got. Let's all speak first, and
I
then we'll go back to
it. I talked to Burlington today, and I called them and asked them about their barking dog ordinance and clucking chicken ordinance. And they told me they give a $50 fine. And I said, well, does that fine graduate up to $100, $200, $500, and so forth? And they told me no. And said, we just go out and give them a warning, basically, and then go out and give them the $50 ticket. We go back again, basically, if it can't be resolved, and said normally it's resolved, that possibly they can go to court. Said in court, though, you got to have your witnesses, and a lot of times they just don't show up at all. Nobody wants to go to court, and it all just sort of fizzles out. But and that's in a community where 50,000 people live side by side versus 50,000 spread out over 300 some square miles. That's all I got to say, and I want to hear the sheriff's report and our citizens. And
now it's my turn.
You skipped me.
Go ahead. I didn't skip anybody.
I'm going to go back to the dogs.
Yeah, I'm going to. Okay. Yeah, okay. But I want to talk about number two. If you'll look at number two on page two, I think that addresses that. And this is the one that I actually wanted to change to add in there on Friday and Saturday, have it till 12 o'clock. which talks about the radios and the stereos and the plan of any radio, television, or other sound reproduction system. And to me, that should take care of not even having a special events permit, but I'll let the sheriff address that as well. But to me, if we change those hours on there, then that would apply to everybody. And that way, they would not have to come in to get a special use permit. They know they got to quit at midnight, and if they don't quit, then, you know, then they get a citation, and you can add a citation in there if they don't stop, which is what you've done, actually, on the civil penalties. I guess that applies to the civil penalties. Is that right?
Yes, ma'am. And actually, if I may, permission, sure. I would like, there was another thing that was asked to be cleared up tonight, too, was there was some confusion I had from a few phone calls regarding the penalties portion of the ordinance.
All right.
And it could be something as simple as adding numbers to the side of it.
Okay.
But I do want to make it clear that everybody understands the first call is a warning. It is a written warning.
Okay.
There's not any civil penalties attached to that.
And
that would be in writing. That's the start of a paper trail so they can identify, you know, repeat offenders, that sort of thing.
Okay. Well, I mean, that's my position on that one. And as far as the dog ordinance is concerned, animal control takes care of the Alamance County as far as the dog ordinance is concerned. So why do we even look at a barking dog for 10 minutes on people that live on 25 acres of land or 30 or whatever? I would just like to take number three out, period, as far as the pets is concerned for the Alamance County, because, you know, I'm afraid of dogs, so don't worry about me. But I just feel like that's too strong to tell people that if a dog barks for 10 minutes, you know, in the country, I think it's just too strong when we already have animal control ordinance. And Mr. Lankford does a great job.
Yeah, and actually,
animal control. And all they have to do is call.
Right.
All they have to do is give him a call, and he will go out there.
And if I may add,
certainly,
I know I had spoken with, again, after we went through planning board, I spoke with Major Brett in the Sheriff's Department,
mm-hmm.
and was reminded that in the animal control ordinance, it does deal with that.
Right.
So. Because at the time when we looked at the animal control ordinance, we were looking at dangerous dogs and those issues, not noisy dogs. And
if that's not in
that
there,
is addressed in that ordinance.
That is addressed in the ordinance. So
yep.
I just think that it's already addressed, and I don't think we should do anything except just take number three out of there.
Yeah,
and that's my opinion now, so we'll have to vote on whatever.
And the animal control ordinance deals with a lot of things other than it deals with animal abuse and neglect.
Exactly.
Things like that.
Exactly.
So.
Okay, Ms. Vaughn?
I was just going to add, you know, it does bother me, and I live in the city limits of a municipality, and when there's a dog barking, there's usually a reason why. It could be a rabbit, it could be a possum, and it's a couple deer. Of course, a couple deer got by them Sunday morning, and they weren't barking, and I spotted them in my yard in the city limits. But I'm concerned also about hunting dogs. They are trained to raise cane. That's the way they're trained, and I hope this is not going to affect them, but can we put that under farming somewhere else? Because I don't want the hunting dogs to be affected by this.
If I may, the discussion originally, this when it first went to the planning board, they sent me back and made me bring it back again at the next planning board meeting with some changes. And one of those was immediately, some of you probably will recall, immediately following that planning board meeting, there was somebody that came and spoke to the commissioners that next Monday about hunting. And that was one of the issues at planning board that they wanted addressed. And that was after Major Britt was at that meeting and he explained that there's other issues that are, you know, statutes and things that deal with discharging a firearm. And that doesn't really come into play on this. So when I went back to make changes, as opposed to rewording it, I felt like it would be most appropriate just delete that section and take that discussion completely out. So this would, I think, in that case, with hunting and things like that, it would still fall. It wouldn't fall under the ordinance. If you strike the pets, that portion out. That should handle that from an enforcement standpoint. And the other thing, one last thing, I'm trying to remember all of the phone calls I've gotten. I did have some concerns expressed to me about turkey shoots and regulating that. again, that falls under that discharging a firearm, and there's so much that goes into turkey shoots. The game warden, I believe, has to be involved with that for the permitting, and that's all part of raising money for charitable causes and things like that. So I want to throw that back to you, though, just that that's a complaint that I've received. So.
Okay. I want to tell y'all, I've been coon hunting, so hey. But at this time, if Mr. Britt, will you come up and talk about the loud noise? Jason, is that?
Sure.
I'm done.
Are you done?
You get that.
And Sheriff Johnson, if you guys will address the noise issue and explain all of your complaints.
Good evening. First of all, let me say we did not author this bill. What we looked at the Sheriff's Department, there's many times that under the prior ordinance that we were answering the same call 7, 8, 9 times. And there was nothing we could do because there were no teeth in the bill stating first time you give a warning, second time a citing them or whatever. There was really just words. And people were being told by county officials, hey, there's an ordinance governing that. There's an ordinance. Well, there was an ordinance, but there was nothing in that bill that we could do. And with the economy being the way it is, we need to better utilize our cars without having to go 7 or 8 times and spending taxpayers' money for gas on the same thing. So we asked that the bill be looked at and some of it be redone as far as giving us some teeth to deal with these individuals that continuously violate the law. And I'm going to turn it over to Chief Britt at this time.
Let me ask a question about, you say, you keep saying no teeth. Over on the old ordinance, says under enforcement, says the violation of any provision of this ordinance shall constitute a misdemeanor. I mean, why is that not a tooth?
What is the punishment?
Yeah.
What is the punishment?
No, describe.
It says, and shall be punishable by a fine of $50 or imprisonment up to 30 days.
Both. So,
I think I can answer that.
Can't you issue an ordinance, summons at that point?
Yes, sir. I think you're right. It does have a penalty. The problem would be that the violation of the law would be excessive, unreasonable noise that needs to be abated or eliminated. And the wording is perceived by a person of ordinary sensibility as interpreting the normal peace and calm of that area. This unreasonably loud and disturbing noise, the following factors should be determined or considered: time of day, proximity, residential structures, is the noise recurrent, intermittent. The problem is, Mr. Sutton, is when we find, going back to the mid-90s when this was enacted, that certainly when you go to court, the deputy says, well, I went out there and I observed it and it was loud. And certainly the person that called thinks it's extremely loud. The person that was doing it thinks it's reasonable and ordinary. So the judge sits back and says, well, there's no benchmark. Please define normal sensibilities. And what I'm saying is, this is a beautifully worded noise ordinance. And we've talked to attorneys, we've talked to other folks, but there's no benchmarks. What we had essentially asked for with the county staff was, we're receiving, for instance, just this year, since January 1st through August 17th, I'm going to run the report for this, we went on 319 separate calls for loud music and noise. Not dogs, not gunshots. This is music and disturbing noises. The lion's share of them, here's some times, 11:46, 12:39, 3:36 a.m., 1:36 a.m., 3:34 a.m., 1:55 a.m., 11:48 p.m., 4 o'clock a.m., 5 o'clock a.m., 1:50, I mean, it goes on and on, just all times of night. And a lot of these places we're going to 9 and 10 times in this same time frame. The problem is we go out, and certainly we got 319 citizens that are like, we want help. There's an ordinance. And we're like, okay, this ordinance says what is reasonable. It doesn't define any, there's no definition. So essentially what we ask for is some benchmarks. Something that says this, and I think the new ordinance, and a lot of, if you look at a lot of local ordinances, they actually define what is disturbing and unnecessary. Matter of fact, this ordinance starts off, the following acts, among others, are declared to be loud. So there is a example of what would be a violation. And that's all we were asking for, some guidance so that the deputies can enforce. The other thing is actually this new ordinance, in whichever form y'all take it, and like I said, we don't have a position with what the governing body sets as the benchmarks. We're just asking for something so that when the deputies go out, we can say, this is the law. This is a violation. This isn't a violation. And it eliminates, because I think we deal with a lot of people that are extremely frustrated because it's over and over and over. And we're averaging, like I said, 50-plus calls a month. That's 50 times that deputy could be in another area trying to prevent some crime instead of going out here because somebody decided that their new $5,000 car speakers sound better at 3 o'clock a.m. when they can hear. And the other thing is we're not in the city. We got people that's hearing it a quarter of a mile away.
Well, forgive me. I'm going to have to disagree with you. If you read one and read the other, yes, there's different wording. There's different semantics. But you still, in my opinion, if you can read English and read between the lines, you still have the tools, in my opinion. I think this one's between more bureaucratic. That's just my personal opinion.
And certainly, like I said, we don't have a position
no offense.
Where the line is set. But since and I've been with the Sheriff's Office since 1995, and I think you can go back and look. The judges, they didn't make them through the first few times, and it's never been charged again. So, I mean, we can choose to. That's certainly y'all's right to set the ordinance.
You understand what he meant by the judges would throw them out because they didn't feel like there was a clear understanding. And that's all we're wanting.
Well, all right, do me a favor. I'm hard-headed. I'm having a party out in the country. And, you know, we're doing some catfishing, doing some serious drinking, and we're playing the music. All right? You come out there and tell me, Joe Brown Farmer over here, or his wife, or, you know, widow, or whatever, you know, she's trying to sleep, or she's been sick. You go over there under the old ordinance and say, turn it down. You know, you got to turn it down. Please. And they don't do it. Versus the old versus the new, where's the tooth that the judge would see?
What is ordinary and reasonable and sensible to a person of, I'll give you the quote again. It, like I said, it's beautifully worded. It's like some political speeches. They sound beautiful and they mean nothing. It essentially says, subject to this provision, it will be unlawful. Let me get back down here. Noise which is perceived by a person of ordinary sensibilities. What is that? You have to define that legally to determine if it rises to that level. As interpreting the normal peace and calm of the area. What is the normal peace and calm of this area versus that area?
And you're reading from the old ordinance.
Yes, right? Yes, sir.
Okay, take it to the new ordinance and read me the section it would cover the same situation with the sharper tooth.
Page 2, and I hadn't read all of this, but I'll look at what I've got. Radio, stereo, set the playing of any radio, television, set, stereo, or other reproduction, musical instrument, sound-producing or sound-amplified device in a manner in such volume, but not limited to the hours of 11 p.m., 6 p.m., so as to annoy or disturb the quiet. It gives you a time.
That's as vague in its definition.
No, yeah, but you got a time.
Except for the time. I was getting ready to say it, except for the time.
It's a hold up in court.
Yeah, except for the time. It's right. Just as vague as the other one. I mean, if you want to say that's vague.
It shouldn't have to go to court, though, is what right. Mr. Britt is saying.
I mean, and I'm certainly we could ponder those things, but that's we're looking for some definition and some benchmarks. What the county says, this is where we want to be a violation, not a violation. We don't have a position on time. We don't have a position on dogs, or no radios, or tractors. Or, I mean, we don't. We just simply want some guidance so that we can enforce it. And we spoke with our legal staff, and they are of the opinion, the same as we are, that this
is non-enforceable.
It's not enforceable.
Well, it also describes that in determining whether the noise is unreasonably loud, disturbing, and unnecessary. That's the big paragraph at the top. Time of day, it addresses all of that again, but then down here, it tells you exactly what it is. And that's where you get your teeth in number two right there, whether it's radios or whatever. So I understand that. Any more questions up here about anything?
So is it going to be law enforcement? You get called to my house because I'm playing loud music. Is it your call that determines whether that music is too loud or not? Although Ms. Massey's already complained, and several other neighbors have already complained. You've gotten complaints.
But you're in the city.
Well, let's move into
remember,
the county.
Remember, this is the remember, this is the county. Okay.
I'm in the county now. Okay.
On 10 acres.
who determines whether
it's... Well, as with any violation of the law, it takes an officer to make a determination if probable cause exists to cite or charge or whatever, however you make it, civil, criminal, or whatever. They will have to present their case, whether it be civilly through the county taking a civil action or criminally as a... the general statutes provide that a violation of county ordinance is a misdemeanor. You have to go before a judge and present your case. Certainly. I hope that if we get something with some clear definitions of what is a violation and what isn't, with some of the in-car camera stuff, some of the other stuff, you can go out and talk to other neighbors. It gives us something to do. To do with the complaint other than just turn it down. And I'll be glad to provide you copies of these calls. I got them from CCOM, from the CAD. I mean, we're going back to the same places. And, I mean, you go out there and you say, turn it down. Particularly the people that's learned the ordinance and learned kind of how to play the system. We've got one guy that basically tells us, he actually called me last week and complained, said, don't send your deputies to my house
no
more.
Well, I hear you, but if it's not 11 o'clock and you go out at 10 o'clock, you don't have any more teeth in one as you do the other, do you? That's my whole point.
It says particularly but not limited to. I think then you would, but it spells out that a stereo, that an amplifier, it's not just an unreasonable noise to the sense and sensibilities. That could be somebody shouting at their wife in the front yard. That could be the dog barking or the truck. I mean, certainly we're not here to take a position of where you as a governing board should set that mark, but we're asking for help in setting a line that we can communicate to the citizens that this is the ordinance, this is the violation of the law, this is not a violation. And where we can act on it instead of going 319 times out to somebody's house and saying, turn it down. We'll be back in an hour. Turn it down. We actually got one guy that tells us, get off my property. You can't do anything with it.
Mm-hmm. So I blame some of them know that.
And turn it up. And it's all, and I agree with you. I live out in the county, and some of these folks I've heard fussing about dogs. I've got 4 hunting dogs. I've got outdoor kennels. We are certainly not wanting to be Big Brother, but we want to be able to help the citizens. And there are 319 people out here too this year that felt like they were being disturbed from a quarter of a mile away or a half a mile away. And there again, that goes back to the officer going out and trying to play peacemaker. It's a shame that we live in a country that neighbors can't get along. But that's why you folks sit there and we stand here.
I thought on one hand that we want less government, but now we turn around and do this.
Clyde says about
the thing. Not your fault.
Is it less government or more government? What if you're the person on the other side of the catfishing and the beer drinking and all that we heard about a while ago, and you're the one that's sick and you can hear it a quarter mile away? Does that person have any less right or more right?
Tim, I know you can understand this. At one time I was living in an apartment. I was working on exams, and this was before all these state exams and federal exams. And one of my students lived right below me in an apartment. They had the music so loud, everything in my china cabinet was rattling, and I could not focus. So I did the cute thing. I called down there, and I said, hey, guys, I've got the scanner on. They've been called to this apartment. Y'all better cut it down. Next thing I knew, it went dead quiet down there. They took off. I don't know where they went, but at least I got my work done.
You're fortunate.
I know. But it's a shame that... It's just a shame. And there are people out there.
Loud music is a problem. I live in Elon. Those kids up there raise hell all weekend long. It doesn't make any difference. 12 o'clock, it doesn't mean anything to them, but there's a band across. It's just, it is a major problem.
Did it to you at their age.
And if it helps, 95% of this is absolutely loud music.
Let me ask you a question. Greensboro News and Record had a story the other day about a man. He said he was in his house and these kids were casing the neighborhood, and they'd drive up in a van. They'd come up in his driveway and they'd get out with crowbars. And they're clearly coming in his house. And they go up and look in the windows and they're saying, hey, is anybody in? And the guy takes a pistol. I don't know if he opened his back door, his front door, his window, but he stuck a gun outside, shot up in the air 3 times. Well, the kids left. Police arrested him for discharging a weapon
Most cities have an ordinance about discharging.
Yeah. Should have came to the door when the cops came.
How would that be handled in Alamance County?
If he's not threatened the children, or this would be my initial inquiry. This is one of those, depends on evidence. But if he has not threatened those young folks with the weapon, he hadn't fired it in an unsafe or careless manner, he's in the county. Shot a gun.
That's no law.
There's nothing there. Now, if he pointed it at them or run out the door, I'll shoot you, and shooting in the air, and there's some evidence of a threat or intimidation. I mean, you get into some things that need to be looked into there. But I think when they asked me to come to a couple of their planning board meetings, and they wanted some real experience of what we were seeing as an office. And I told them, leave firearms alone. If it's fired in an improper manner, or if it's fired in an unsafe, assaultive manner, there are state statutes that take care of that. If it's being fired to harass or intimidate somebody, there's state statutes to take care of that. We're interested in noise, loud music. We need some help.
Leave a man and his dog. That's where we need help.
Yeah, the other stuff, the hunting stuff. There are plenty of statutes that cover that stuff. We need some help with the noise and the music.
Okay. Any more questions?
Not after 11. Not between 11 and 6.
Well, certainly that's we don't take a position on time. Whatever the board says, we'll enforce. But we can just tell the citizens this is what your county commissioner, Ms. Vaughn, has said is the appropriate time. And if it's
turn it
after
off
this,
at 1 o'clock.
Turn it off. We'll take care of it.
Yeah.
Thank you, Tim.
Thank you.
Okay. At this time, I will take, and I guess we just have to raise your hand if you want to speak about anything. I had one here. Actually, I told Mr. Durham first. He's on the list. Frankie, I know Frankie. I can call him Frankie.
Well, if y'all are going to amend it and just do away with it, it's no need of me standing here and just saying what I need to say now. But, you know, if that's entirely up to y'all. But what I'm saying, this gentleman, I forget his name, that was on the planning board.
Jason
Martin. He's talking about other counties. This county. This is Alamance County. This is not some other county. Leave them alone. You worry about my county. You worry about my dogs. As far as enforcement of this ordinance, the sheriff's department can't enforce the littering on the highway. How many littering tickets have you seen written in this county? Go up and down the highways and look at it. I think he's just said they've got enough to do. You know, there's the animal control. If they want to do this, you know, let them come out. But leave my dogs alone. I'm out in the county. They're going to bark if something come up, like Ms. Vaughn said. I guarantee you I could take half of these people that from the city in here and take them to the country at night. They won't know the difference in a coyote barking. than a dog barking. You start fussing and there's a coyote howling over here. There's a fox barking over here. There's a cow over there in the pasture ball. You know, am I going to go arrest a cow on a full moonlit night? Here's the geese fly over. They honk all night. Are you going to arrest them?
Nobody owns them.
That's right. Nobody owns them.
I agree.
But, you know, everything is so politically correct now, and everything is so much government, this and that and the other. Let's go back to a little bit of common sense. And my dogs, I'll go out and shut them up if they start barking. For instance, I went out one night, shut them up, started barking. Didn't know what they was barking at. Went back to the porch, cut the lights on, flood lights all around the house. Made them shut up. Went back, went to bed, started barking. I get up, my underwear, put my gun in my hand, go out to the dog lot.
We're getting a visual here.
Making me mad. Get a switch, pull it off a tree, hit the side of the fences, say, shut up now, I done told you. Well, bless God, it was done stole my damn four-wheeler. I'm in my shed there and pushed it across the front yard, and I didn't know, and my dogs was telling me they're out there stealing something.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
So
they've only got 10 minutes.
But anyhow, you know, help me out with the dogs. I love my hunting dogs. They're going to bark. A coon dog's going to bark at moon some night. If he hears the siren from these guys that come up the road, he's going to start howling. If another one comes up the road, he's going to start howling. You know, and that's 5 minutes, 10 minutes. And if the fire trucks come before the sheriff's department comes, they're going to start howling. They're going to bark. So are you going to fuss at me about them barking? No, don't fuss at me. Get the heck on out of my driveway, go on back to the house. Leave me alone. Leave my dogs alone. They're there to do my job, to hunt with. And this is a hunting county. It's a farming county. And, if, you know, please leave our guys alone. Let us be. And we would appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Frank. Okay. I think he's about the dogs, too. And yeah, that's Mr. Hall. He's on here. Have y'all got the timer on? It's 3 minutes.
Frankie, I had a similar experience, but it wasn't a four-wheeler that got stolen. Dogs barked two or three different times, and I went to see about them. The third time, I carried me a flashlight. And thank God I did, because there was a copperhead snake laying there next to the lot. And if I was a dog, and a copperhead snake laying right next to my bed, I'd appreciate if somebody come get him away from there too. Like the lady said, most time dogs bark at something or because of something. My name is Dr. James Hall. I'm a retired minister, a property owner for 38 years in this county, a taxpayer and registered voter. I'm a breeder of beagle dogs. I'm a member of the American Kennel Club, the Purina Professional Breeders Club, and I represent a rather substantial group of property owners and hunters, including the Quail Farm Beagle Club with some 78 to 80 members. And we have a petition asking, signed with several pages worth, asking to not pass this proposal that is before us. We strongly oppose the dog ordinance that you're proposing. We feel there are enough laws on the books already. And we're a reasonable group that realize that every citizen has rights. But we oppose this ordinance because it goes too far and it's unnecessary. We already got enough rules in the books. In society, as has been mentioned, we need to learn how to live together under the laws of the land. It protects the rights of everyone. Thomas Jefferson said the best government is the least government. While in college at Elon, I had a political science professor say that every time a law is passed, somebody loses some freedom. What might protect me or be good for me takes away from somebody else. Now, I've lived for 38 years, 16 miles from Main Street. When I moved out 2 miles from Caswell County, there weren't as many houses as there are now. It was a farming community, still is, but we're getting more and more one-acre lot houses and that sort of thing. Many of them people moving from town that aren't used to some of the noises that you have outdoors. I presently have 10 beagle dogs. I keep my kennels clean. I spend quite a bit of money on dog food, vet bills, vaccinations, etc. I don't let my dogs run loose except when we're in the woods either training or hunting them. We do have an English bulldog who comes in and out of the house, but we have an electric invisible fence that keeps her in her own yard. Now, many people have dogs not just as pets or as hunting dogs, but as guard dogs, as Frankie was talking about with the stealing going on there a while ago. Many people have been awakened at night by a dog that who let them know that the house was on fire. I pastored a rather large church in Fayetteville, North Carolina, several years ago, and some of you, the sheriff and the people, may recall back in the mid-80s.
Please make it short. Your time is...
Okay. I'm about done anyway. Okay. This group of ninjas from Fort Bragg came in and brutally slayed two elderly people. If they'd had a little dog to bark and let them know it, perhaps those folks would have still been alive. They, with all the crime rate going on, it looked to me like adding more responsibility to our law enforcement would be ridiculous. I mean, with all the law enforcement has to do to add all this to it and everything, I mean, I recall when the 55-mile speed limit came into effect. They had a...
I'm going to have to ask you to stop, okay? Please, it's almost 5 minutes. It's almost 5 minutes. So.
Please don't pass this ordinance.
Okay.
On your petition, how many names did you have?
We'd be glad to take it. How many names do you have?
It's out of his store, but it was out at Brunner's store.
Do you have any idea how many?
I think it's less than 50.
But quite a few.
Yes, sir, quite a few. I mean, these were mostly hunting people. Okay. I saw the list, and I don't remember how many was on it, but I did see the list and sign it.
But we were more concerned with the 7:30 hunting, no shooting, and things before you amended those things. But we're still concerned with the dogs and everything. But thank you again for your time.
Does anybody else want to talk on the dogs? You want to talk on the dogs? Okay. And then we'll get to something else. I know you got something else for you. Let's finish this one, okay?
It is.
We have many cases here in defense of dog barking. I have an opposite case. I would like to present a case when dogs are not hunters.
Pull that mic down.
I'm Dr. Rice.
Okay, pull that mic down.
I'm Dr. Rice, and I moved to beautiful North Carolina for the purpose of quiet and writing book and studying and learning and writing. Okay, this is a different kind of case. Say dogs are not there to hunt or to guard or to night watch. They're just little house pets. But they are trained to do one thing, to control neighborhood with their barking. They're always attended by the owners. And they're always controlled in every way of their behavior. The owners decide when they bark and when they don't bark. And this is a way of controlling neighborhood and neighbors. When dogs are attended by handlers or owners, it really doesn't take long to make them quiet. And I've seen it happening. Except it's done selectively. So in this case, I feel that barking serves no other purpose than disturbing neighborhood and disturbing neighbors and basically controlling neighbors' behavior. Who goes where, when, the dogs, through the dogs. Dogs actually are just as much a source of noise as anything else. And this is a source that could be turned on and off, up or down. And it doesn't take 10 minutes, it doesn't take even 5 minutes to tell the dog, sit, when dog is always attended by owner. That's all.
Have you called animal control?
Yes, animal control is not responsible for noise. They told me this, I called them a few times.
Well, I think that may change at this point, and Mr. Britt will address that, because normally I think it was for vicious dogs. Am I right, Tim? But I think that can be changed on that, and if it's an obnoxious dog.
I discussed this.
But I think you have a bad neighbor, Ms. Rice, is what I'm understanding, maybe.
So I think I have freedom for my quiet and peace, just as much as dogs have freedom to bark.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, any more dogs? Anybody want to speak on the dogs? Okay, if not, Ms. Kerr, I'll address you at this time. Hey, Sue.
I'm Beverly Kerr.
Alamance County citizen, small business owner, and I have a totally different concern. I'm concerned about businesses that are in an area that disrupt the peace of the neighborhood. And so I was looking through the ordinance, and I was so pleased to see several things. For instance, it says soundproofing and muffling of equipment is recommended. Loading and unloading operations should not be excessively loud and noisy, especially at night. An operation which causes noise due to the explosion of operating gases or fluids should be muffled to deaden the noise so as not to disturb the public. Well, these are exactly the noises that disturb my community. And then as I looked further down the ordinance, I hope I'm wrong. Did it say that businesses are exempt from all of these issues? Is that right?
Jason.
Is that right, Jason?
How can that be? How can that be that all businesses are exempt from disturbing the peace of the community? That's my concern, but I have a solution for this. It's a simple one. The real problem is, how does one determine when sounds associated with operations of a business are normal or when they are disturbing and unnecessarily loud? The solution is an inexpensive noise meter that the Sheriff's Department could carry with them. When they are asked to investigate a noise violation, it would be so much simpler if they could measure the noise and document it in their reports. There would be no question about the enforcement of the ordinance if we set acceptable levels of noise for the day and for the night, like many other counties do. So, please consider setting maximum sound levels for day and night in Alamance County and have our Sheriff's Department carry noise meters to measure sound levels to verify violations. This will simplify enforcement. And I was present at the planning board meetings, and several of the planning board members thought this was a good idea, and I hope you'll really give it serious thought. I think it's a simple solution. Thank you.
Thank you. Sue was, I think Sue raised her hand too at the same time. I'll give you an answer. Sue, if you want to come on.
Thank you. My name is Sue Dayton, and I'm an Alamance County resident, and I own a small farm. And I have a dog, and fortunately my dog is not a problem, and so I'm not here to talk about dogs tonight. I do want to say, though, that the special events permit, I don't really see a problem with that because it said that you may get a permit, you know, for like a wedding or a party or such. And I'm thinking that in the case that you might have a bad neighbor, that actually it may come in handy, because then if your bad neighbor comes over and says, shut that music off, you're getting married today, so what? You know, then you can just say, excuse me, I have a permit, you know. So, I mean, it doesn't say shall, it says may. So, if that's any consolation. I do want to side with the sheriff and Mr. Britt that the ordinance really, in my opinion, it's getting there, but it's not there yet. If you're going to have an ordinance, you've got to have some standards in it, and I agree that it has to have some teeth. Because as I look through this right now, I see a lot of words, loud and excessive sounding, noise creating, annoyance, amplifier, speakers, sound, noises. This is the sounding of a horn. It's very subjective, and I can see that it would be a waste of, you know, our sheriff's time and money to go out, because it happens again and again and again, because it has no teeth, and these things are very subjective. I'm also here tonight on behalf of my friendship with Beverly Kerr and what she's had to endure for quite a few years now. And I do believe that businesses should be included in this ordinance simply because we live in a county without zoning. That is Alamance County. That's what makes Alamance County as we know it right now. And I feel for Beverly. Just the other day, her husband was telling me that they can no longer have campfires in the backyard and roast marshmallows or have hot dogs over a campfire with their children. The noises are so loud in the night that they jump in the bed, huge noises. And I think, again, that this is a problem. It's a dilemma because of our zoning problem. It may or may not be a problem. And I see pros and cons, you know, to zoning in Alamance County. But I think that right now, this is the way we must live. You know, we have folks that live, we're cohabitating, you know, residences with businesses. And I think that we each need to give a little bit. And I think that possibly Beverly's suggestion about the decibel meter would come in very handy for something like this. And I think it's time. So I would like to request that you all think about what Beverly said and think about her situation, because I'm sure she's not the only person in Alamance County with this problem. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Come on, Ian. Y'all know me.
3 minutes.
what is this, Chapel Hill? I lived down Hopedale all my life, back when Copeland's run 3 doggone shifts 7 days a week. I lived 3/4 to a mile away from the plane, and you could sit there and hear them looms and them spinning and clack, 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 clack all night long. I mean, get real, people. We're going to got no business, and you're going to put something else on to them to make it worse. Now, so I can't speak to, I don't like nothing about this order, so I'm going to speak to the part that I remember from being young. I can remember coming in from work, not getting in by 6 o'clock, eating by the supper, playing with the youngin', watching a little TV, going out there and beating on that old truck to 11, 12, 1 o'clock, trying to get that thing where it would run and go to work the next day. I can't no more, and I don't have to, thankfully. But this is elitist. I mean, in other words, if you take these, like, I had to work on my house. When am I going to work on my house? I can't, you know, I got a job, I got kids. If I'm working on my house and knocking a hammer 12 o'clock at night because I'm able to do it, I don't want the law showing up and saying, you came down here beating with this hammer and using a skill saw. I got to do it when I got to do it. I mean, some people do, you know, still have to do it. And so I want you to think about that when you go in. I don't like nothing about this order, so, really. The loud music, there's a time when I like loud music. Now, my usual loud is because I can't hear it, so I have to turn it up. But anyway, think about this thing. We don't need to be Chapel Hill. Oh.
Well, I don't think your hammer would be excessive noise, though. I don't think it. Oh.
Can I make a
comment? Anybody else? Yes, sir, Henry. Let's get through to you first. Don't you read me no 3-page book now.
Oh, I'm not. I just got an ordinance down here.
Name?
My name's Henry Vines. I'm a resident here in Alamance County, a farmer. I'm also with the Alamance County Farm Bureau and a concerned citizen. I have some problems with some issues that are in this ordinance. One is the animal, and I'm not some pets. I'm not going to talk about dogs, but in this ordinance, I mean, it includes birds, it includes, you know, all kinds of animals. A lot of people like to hear a crow, rooster crow in the morning. That could be obnoxious to some people. And I know that y'all are already discussing about doing away with this, and I would recommend that y'all do away with this and put this back where it belongs in the animal control. The other thing I have is about the loud speakers and amplifiers. We have farm tours. There's all kinds of events and such that goes on, and we use bullhorns, you know, on the truck. And that's not to disturb anyone, but we got 200-plus people, and that's just so that everyone can hear. And I'd hate to think that we wouldn't be able to use that because, you know, we don't want to break the law, but, I mean, we'd probably be done and gone before the police got there, you know. But I think that's another, you know, an issue. Also, the one you all addressed is about a bona fide farm. I think we need to leave this as a farm operation because some people may not qualify under the state statute as a bona fide farmer. And if you say you're supposed to be for profit, that may melt us all out because it's been kind of hard to make a profit, period, you know. But I think we need to leave that as farming operations and just take off the bona fide. The other thing is the special events permit. The thing that I don't understand about this, and it's not in this ordinance, and there is no clarification, is what qualifies for a permit. Who is going to be able to receive a permit? What's the criteria for rejection of a permit? It says down here private parties. Is the sheriff department going to handle 200 people coming in asking for a permit for a private party so that they won't be subject to being, you know, violating order? I would hope not. I don't think Terry wants that responsibility, having, you know, everybody wants to have a private party, and we have them out in the country, Terry knows, you know, pig pickings and such. I mean, but am I going to have to come to ground every time and get a permit when I want to have a party? I think there needs to be some clarification. The permit needs to be issued. You need a clarification of what the permit is and who's going to get the permit. You know, and is this permit basically allowing you to violate the noise ordinance?
Okay. That's your time, is it?
Thank you for your time. I appreciate it.
Okay. Anybody else? Yes, sir. Please say your name, sir.
Greg McDaniel, just a resident of the county. The only thing that I have a question on with the farming operations. I understand farmers have to make a living, the bona fide thing, that's up to y'all if y'all want to make that or not. It doesn't really affect me at all. My problem that I'm having is what defines farming operations as far as noise goes. I know they got to run their tractors, they got to have their animals, they got to do things like that. But where I've called the sheriff's office to come to help with my situation is where a radio is being played that can be heard for a half mile to a mile away, but it's on a farm. It's just music being played. It has nothing to do with farming whatsoever. Sheriff's office comes out, can't do anything about it, tells me they can't do anything about it. I can't be outside with my son playing baseball, playing football, doing things in my yard I want to do because I've got this music blaring across my neighborhood. I'd just like for y'all to fix that so the sheriff's office can put an end to it. So I can
I think that would come under excessive noise, and that's why they want something so they can do something about it, okay?
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, sir. Any more questions from the audience? Yes, sir. Please speak your name.
My name is Bernie Filmer.
Okay.
I live up on Boone Road. Mm-hmm. And with the noise from turkey shoots from the Citizen Club off under Burley Drive, they're in the back of my house. And on Friday and Saturday nights, they're shooting quite a few shots, some rapid fire. You cannot go to bed. My wife would wake up terrified. My granddaughter won't stay with us anymore because she's afraid. And it just seems that these could be done in the daylight hours and not done after 10 o'clock at night or up to 10 o'clock at night. And there's neighbors all around the place. I don't even know how they got a permit to be there. I mean, this one guy can't put his goats out because they're shooting adjacent to his farm and he can't put a fence up, afraid that his goats are going to get shot. Now, I wish you could look into this, and also these ladies here that brought up about the meter for the sheriff's department, I think it's an excellent idea. It gives you some backing. And a meter doesn't lie. It tells you what's excessive. You don't have to put a number on it.
Okay.
Thank you for your time.
Yes, sir. Sheriff Johnson, can you address the meter issue, or do you know how much it would cost or whatever?
About $300 or $400 per meter.
Per meter? Okay,
or
Jason.
Meter.
Okay, Jason.
Stand up and
I'm going to let Jason address that.
I was going to say, I actually did some research on that very thing, because okay. Like I said before, this is where it all started, was with meters.
Okay.
Basically, there was something, I believe, it was brought up at the planning board meeting regarding meters, that you could get them at Radio Shack for $49. And I'm just going to read the description here I printed today off of Radio Shack's webpage. It says, get precise readings when you fine-tune audio response of a stereo, PA, or home theater system. So it's obviously for home use. And what Major Britt had explained to me and what Sheriff Johnson was just saying is that these things would need to be certified meters in order to stand up in court. And from professionalequipment.com, here's one for $399. Here's one that specifically states for law enforcement and for OSHA compliance for $249. They really go anywhere up to about $800-$900. Depends on how accurate and how broad of a range of decibels you want to have. And there was some discussion regarding decibel levels at the planning board meeting in general. And part of the issue there of setting a decibel level, you can do that and set it to OSHA terms, because OSHA does set acceptable decibel levels for different uses. And I had looked into that a little bit. The only issue there is setting a distance to properly measure this. What height do you measure it from? My high school physics is failing me, but I know that sound travels over distance. It decays over distance as well. There's a formula for that. You have to take those things into consideration. Does it travel over water? Does it travel downhill? Is it buffered by trees? Those sorts of things could change from place to place. So setting that level is scientifically very difficult, but some places do that. They do put in decibel levels for industrial land uses, for residential land uses, for commercial land uses, so on and so forth. And this goes back to the issue of the exemption for business, which you asked me a few minutes ago, if I may take the time just to address that question as well.
Exactly.
And Mr. Boswell was at the planning board meeting, and I think I stated at exhaustion about the issue being a nuisance ordinance and not a land use ordinance, where a lot of places like New Hanover County, for example, they tie these decibel levels and these meter levels to land use districts. They will tie it to their zoning ordinance, to a residential district, to an industrial district, to a commercial district, so on and so forth. In Alamance County, of course, we do not have countywide zoning, and this, in a way, if we were to put in buffer areas and those things, just I cautioned the planning board, and I would caution the board, you all tonight as well, that could be seen as a form of de facto zoning, and I would caution on that, because this is a nuisance issue. That most of the complaints they're getting are dealing with music and things like that, not the use of the land.
Okay.
That's a much broader issue and a deeper issue. But that's all I have.
Sure. Mr. Britt, how many cars would have to have this? All of the sheriff's cars at this point, or how many?
I think you could probably get by with maybe a couple of shifts. That way you got one on the north side, one on the south side. I don't see the need in putting one in every car. Certainly they could supervise or something if you get by there. I did want to add one thing. As y'all have now got to see, there are passionate sides on both sides of this. And all we've asked for is somebody give us a guidance so we can answer these folks' questions. And we'll enforce
whatever. And we want to do what we think is right, too.
Absolutely. And we'll enforce whatever you have. But I think a couple of shifts, maybe eight.
Sure. Jason.
Yes, ma'am.
I noticed the letter up here, and this may be the same gentleman that called me about the dirt bikes and the excessive noise that on a dirt bike, and he said in our conversation that the gentleman told him that the muffler that was on the dirt bike came on it.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it could be that they just, you know, put El Cheapo mufflers on there. Is there anything in this ordinance that will handle that? It's excessive noise.
Yeah.
I think the dirt bikes is on for me.
It is on there.
Ms. Vaughn. Ms. Vaughn.
Yes, sir.
On those dirt bikes, if I may, they have a baffle in it.
I don't have one, but I've been around. They have a baffle inside the muffler. It, all it does is you can screw that baffle out, and it's just the same thing as a straight pipe. And then when he comes home, he can put that baffle right back in. So, I mean, it's, you know, I was just expressing that so they can say, well, when you come, then it's right back to this normal level. It's not a straight pipe. It's just a baffle inside that screws out and then screws right back in.
So you can get, that takes away that screeching and that awful, terrible noise that this gentleman is complaining about.
Yeah, and I think under the, on page 2, under number 6, it discusses exhaust discharge, the discharge in the open of the exhaust of any steam engine and stationary internal combustion engine, right, motor vehicle, recreational vehicle, except through a muffler or other device which will effectively prevent loud or explosive noises therefrom. And if you go up to the top of that same page, the very last sentence of the second paragraph there, it discusses the whether the noise is subject to being controlled without unreasonable effort or expense to the creator thereof. And that's going to be a judgment call on behalf of the law enforcement officer. But to me, if it's a stock muffler that comes on something, I think that has to be taken into consideration. If it's stock and they're not going out of their way to make it noisier, those are things that the law enforcement officer would have to take into consideration. Because doing anything more than that, they could make an argument that it's unreasonable and too expensive to do.
Can you explain continuing this public hearing until, do we want to vote on this tonight, or we want the changes made, or
I think, I think we maybe need to do some revisions, send it back to Jason to redo it.
And you talked to me about not having
some revisions.
Can you explain what you told me?
I would defer to Clyde on this, Clyde, from a legal standpoint.
We have to do this. We have to go back through this whole process of advertising again.
You can amend the ordinance tonight if you want.
Well, I think that tonight? I think we need to send it back. That's what Eddie would like to do, and get a new version.
Yeah, I think we need to send it back too.
Right.
And how about you guys, Kim?
Well, I'm not going to vote for it. That's not is it in its current status. So sure.
Yeah. Right. Okay. That's why we're saying.
And I see it. Everybody needs to work on it.
I want to ask a question. What? And forgive me for not knowing, but what did we vote on before about dogs and
noise? Oh, okay. That was in the animal control ordinance. Right. That was regarding potentially dangerous dogs and nuisance dogs. Basically, dogs that scatter trash, things like
and
that.
And that's separate from
this. It's totally separate from this. Okay. But the point is, I want to make clear that noisy dogs is actually regulated under that ordinance and has been since that ordinance was first passed back in 89, I think. So that is something that's separate under that ordinance, along with animal abuse and neglect. There's a lot of things. What I was asked to look at that time was a very small portion of the ordinance, just dealing with nuisance animals and civil penalties. But the dogs, noisy dogs, is actually already handled under that ordinance. So I think the point that the Sheriff's Department was making tonight is that it could be left to that ordinance and not included in this at all.
And scratch 3.
And scratch, sure.
So are we in agreement to send it back at this time? And then, Clyde, you can inform us of what we need to do. Okay.
You notice again in front of the public hearing because you have a new ordinance.
Okay, that's fine.
It's better practice is to let the public know.
That's fine.
Because it'll
no problem.
Right. What I'm hearing tonight is going to be completely changed.
So if do I hear motion that we do this?
So moved.
I have a motion, second. On favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Aye. So we'll just send it back in.
And Madam Chair, we do have a planning board meeting on Thursday night, and I'll present it to them then.
All right.
And I'll have something prepared.
You've got the notes on what we've a
Let
lot
me
of
Let ask you a question about the planning committee.
Yes, sir.
Back when we made the changes that we made, and I protested the fact that we were doing some of the things that we were doing, and I think I showed more than credible evidence that the norm in our state for counties our size weren't doing what we were doing. And I still stand on that. I can bring that back if I need to. But is there a total change of philosophy on this planning board versus what we had before?
I'm just speaking from you. Are you asking for my personal opinion?
Well, I don't. I didn't ask Clyde.
Be honest with you, sir. I don't see any change in philosophy on
this. Are you serious?
I do not.
I think a lot of what's coming down the pike has been predicted, and the atmosphere's there, the philosophy's there, and we've heard it tonight. We've had speakers tonight that are very pro changing that plan committee. They want us to do the decibels. They want us to do other things. I tell you what, the public better be aware of what's going on in that planning committee.
And I will say, in defense of the planning board, they could have put that in this ordinance, and they chose not to.
Well, they could do much better things, too, in my opinion.
And the meeting's Thursday night at 7.
What meeting?
The planning board meeting.
I'll be working.
Oh, okay.
I don't have a guaranteed job. The lady that had can I say one thing about dogs that bark because of what's going on elsewhere? And you said, you know, I had a German Shepherd for a while, and I didn't have her for protection. I love German Shepherds, and I had her because I loved her. And she would pick up on somebody walking down the street a block away. She couldn't even see them, but she knew they weren't from the neighborhood, or she knew that they weren't local or had been friendly to her, and she couldn't even see them. I don't know, she could hear them, but I don't know, she'd start barking, and all I had to do was look out the front door. Sure enough, somebody was walking down the street, totally oblivious as far as sight goes. One day she went crazy, and I looked out the window where she was, and she was just barking like crazy to somebody behind my house, or looking behind my house, and I knew something drastic was going on. She wouldn't do that. So I went out the back door, and as soon as I went out, I saw a man crouching down. I don't see how she even saw him. Crouching down, going up under the deck of the lady's house right behind my house. And Frida saw him. And she was going crazy. And I went out to the fence, and I hollered at the guy. I said, "Hey, get out from under that house." And he came out from under that house. He said, "Somebody's trying to kill him." I said, "I'm okay if you don't get out from under that house." And that guy left and ran up the street. Well, what he was, he had gone into restaurants all over the area and would order his food and eat and then get up and leave or run, and a manager was chasing him, you see. Well, you know, I'm proud of my dog. I'm proud that she did go crazy. Amen. And, you know,
well,
I just...
I pay for my meals, and I don't deserve to be bartered. We're talking about every day, for more than an hour, continuously, selectively, deliberately, for 2.5 years.
Okay.
And all I do is walk on my property. Mm-hmm. And we're talking about a dog that is stopped at anybody else. He's not allowed to bark there.
How long have you been living there?
I've been living there for 4 years about.
And you moved into a neighborhood that's got dogs, right?
The neighbor moved after me, yes.
You moved in a neighborhood that's got dogs. So get that.
No, that neighborhood does not have dogs.
But, well,
that is the only dog that moved after me.
Okay, well, thank you. Is that enough, Tim? Okay, our next item on the agenda is Habitat for Humanity Week proclamation. Carolyn Christmas, president of Habitat for Humanity. Where is Miss Carolyn?
I don't see her.
She's probably in the other room.
Robin.
Oh, okay.
Thank you for coming.
This guy used to coach me when I played basketball for Paint Oil Company. I want to tell y'all that. This is John Chambers.
Thank you for being here.
It's been a long time ago. Yes, ma'am. If you would just give your name, please.
Sure. My name is Robin Wintering.
I knew you weren't coming, Christmas.
I'm Robin Wintringham. I'm the executive director of Habitat for Humanity. And our board chair, Carolyn Christmas, could not be here this evening.
Hang on a minute, Robin.
Hey.
Gentlemen.
We got somebody talking, please. Thank you, Bill. That's all right. Bye. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
That's okay. My name is Robin Wintringham. I'm the executive director of Habitat for Humanity. Our board chair, Carolyn Christmas, could not be here tonight, so I'm here representing the Ministry of Habitat.
Okay, and so what you want is for us to do the proclamation?
That would be great. Or
has everybody read the proclamation about the Habitat for Humanity Week in Alamance County?
That's a great idea.
Do I hear a motion then that
so
we
moved.
Approve this? I have a, yes. All righty.
Very good.
Everybody in favor say aye.
Aye.
You will get it.
Great, thank you very much.
And that is for the week of September the 14th through the 20th.
It is, okay. And I'd just like to take this opportunity to thank you all for all that you do for the Ministry of Habitat. We certainly appreciate your support and your encouragement. We've been very lucky lately with the help of Jason Martin and the Planning Department to secure $250,000 grant from the North Carolina Department of Commerce, and that's enabled us to start an 18-house subdivision in Graham. So I want to thank you all, and also on Ben Court. That's exactly right. And the first house is finished and passed final today. But anyhow, just wanted to thank you all for your support, and thank you for generously affording us the opportunity to utilize the expertise of county employees and to host county employees to work on our job site. So thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Rob.
Okay, the next thing is Family Day Proclamation, Alexa Jordan and Tony Roper.
I'm Alexa Jordan, and of course, and it is our, as co-chairs of the Community Council, Friends and Families Committee, that we ask you to adopt the proposed proclamation of September 28th, Monday, September 28th, as Family Day in Alamance County. This, Tony has just handed out to you another flyer that we are using to publicize this. It is a national day established by CASA, which is the National Center for Addiction and Substance Abuse. We believe that families, strong families, are important to every community, and particularly to the children being reared in those communities. So we're asking that families eat together, and if you see in our brochure, we're asking that we have handouts if they want for ideas for talking and listening and being stars for Family Day. So we ask you to support this. We have other things that we'll be doing. We are asking the Ministers Association to, on that Sunday before, discuss family issues and encourage families eating together on that Monday. Tony and I will be speaking on WBAG on the 25th about Family Day. And we're asking also that in the newspapers, maybe in the food section, they develop menus for families to share on that day.
Anybody have any questions? Mr. Roper, do you want to say anything?
Well, just
I'll
to
let you talk.
Yeah, well, just to reiterate, I mean, you know, with the economy the way it is, and a lot of people who are working, a lot of times we are away from our kids. We don't sit down like, I guess, quote unquote, in the old days and have a meal with our family. We really just want to bring that awareness to our county, so that, you know, if you are out working late, you know, hey, look, we might have to have a late meal, but look, turn off the TV, we're going to get at the table, and we're going to sit, we're going to eat, and we're going to communicate. So that's really what we're pushing here with this Family Day.
Okay.
Great idea.
Thank you.
Okay, so I'll entertain a motion at this time.
Move.
Have a motion.
Second.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you all very much.
Hope that works out great. Okay, the next thing on my agenda is the Library Circulation Services Policy, and I think we all have a copy of that.
Good evening and greetings from Alamance County Public Libraries. With the completion of our longtime contractual arrangement with Chatham County Public Libraries, we are proposing some changes to our Library Circulation Services Policy. The revision of the policy was first reviewed by both the county attorney and the assistant county attorney. Following that, the circulation services policy was reviewed and approved by the Alamance County Library Committee, our advisory board, at their regular meeting on August 18, 2009. The proposed changes are highlighted in yellow in the policy document that you have in your packet. And in summary, the revision includes changes to limit checkout items to 5 for new library card holders, to require a library patron to pay the entire balance on their library account when the library card is renewed, that's every 2 years, to increase the processing fee for lost items from $3 to $5, to limit refunds on return of lost and paid items to 1 year, and to change the age requirement from 16 to 17 years of age in order to obtain a library card without parental or guardian permission. It would also require that the cardholder be 17 years old to check out movies, and this brings the library definition of adult into alignment with the current internet computer access policy at the library. With your approval, we propose to implement these changes beginning January the 1st, 2010. This would allow time for advising library patrons of the upcoming changes to the circulation services policy. I'd be happy to answer any questions that you have.
Anybody got any questions on these? I do read them all.
Looks like good changes to me.
Yep.
Needs to be done.
Not, I'd entertain a motion at this time.
So moved.
Second. Motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay, and I'd like to give you a very quick update on the new public library to be built in Elon. Of course, it's going to be built at Beth Schmidt Park. It'll be approximately 15,000 square feet, and the Elon Board of Aldermen have approved Jenkins Peer as the architectural firm to design the new library. The architects have completed the conceptual design phase and will soon begin work on the design of the building. The Friends of the Alamance County Public Libraries are kicking off a fundraising campaign for books for the new Elon Library next month, and they've already pledged $50,000 for new books. At their annual meeting this coming November, the Alamance County Library Committee will review their bylaws and consider adding Elon representation to the Library Advisory Board. Once this has been formally discussed by the Library Committee in November, I will bring this amendment back to you all for your approval. Any questions about that?
What's the square footage of the meeting room that's going to be here?
It will seat at least 100 people. I don't have the square footage with me tonight, but we want to make sure it's going to be available after hours.
How much does Graham seat? Because I was in that not long ago.
Graham's is much smaller. Yeah. I would say 35 to 50, mm-hmm. something like that. Depends on if you have tables or just an audience arrangement. May Memorial seats 85.
Yeah, I've been in that one. Okay.
And I'd like to thank you all for your support of our public libraries.
Thank you, dear.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay, next on our agenda is electronics recycling program. And Emily, how do you pronounce your last name?
Feller. Without the zero, the O.
Okay. It's a silent O.
Yes. And I actually have a slide.
Okay.
Good evening, Madam Chair and Commissioners. Thank you for the opportunity to present a brief progress report regarding our expanded recycling program that now includes electronics. And under the electronics program, we will be accepting a large variety of items that include computer equipment, VCRs, televisions, microwaves, printers, rechargeable batteries, vacuum cleaners, and other similar items. Here's a picture of some of the variety of material we've already accepted. Televisions are the most common item that we receive. We've seen all shapes and sizes from consoles from the 70s to TV VCR combos from the 80s. To the big monster big screens from the 90s. Old computers are also a common item that we receive as people switch to lighter flat screens. And you can see the lead landfill attendant, Daryl Redding, is organizing the monitors on a pallet there. We also accept many smaller household items like fans, power tools, any kinds of cords or cables. And here's a sample of the small electronics that we accept. We accept just about anything that plugs into the wall and bring it out to us. Although technically state law will not ban the computer equipment and televisions from disposal in the landfills until January 1, 2011, we want to move forward because recycling these items is the right thing to do, not just now, not just 15 months from now, but now. And we've arranged for our contractor, Creative Recycling Systems of Morrisville and RTP, to pick up, transport, process, and recycle all of the items for essentially no cost or low cost, depending on the mix of electronics to TVs. CRS is ISO 14001 certified, and is one of the three vendors selected on the North Carolina term contract for electronics recycling. Over 80 counties, municipalities, and school systems in North Carolina employ CRS services already, and 100% of the material will be recycled. We started separating these items on August 3rd, and the only promotion that we did was actually handing out flyers to incoming customers. As of August 28th, we collected more than 45 pallets which averages out to about 11 pallets per week. Our first shipment was August 24th, which is 3 weeks after starting the program. And we had more material ready to ship than room on the truck. We shipped 28 pallets, which weighed just over 12,000 pounds.
Who takes this material?
CRS, okay. Creative Recycling System. The electronics building was full before the first shipment. We were staging the waste outside, separating into like items before the truck got there. And then we had our lead landfill attendant, or our landfill attendant, Lee Kohler, to load the pallets on the truck. And it was a tractor trailer, and it took just under 45 minutes to load it the first time. So, you might ask the question, why are we recycling these electronics, televisions, and other electrical items? According to the EPA, more than 40 million computers became obsolete in 2007 alone. There was an average of 24 purchased electronic devices per household in 2008. And the television conversion flipped the switch to digital in June 2009. 17 states have passed legislation on electronics or e-waste recycling. 11 more states are considering the issue during the next congressional session, with North Carolina having passed legislation in 2007 to be effective in 2010 and 2011. As technology evolves, this type of waste will just continue to increase, and many of our Alamance County citizens have eagerly awaited this program. Furthermore, materials diverted from the landfill disposal saves valuable airspace and extends the life of the landfill. Some of the recyclables contain heavy metals such as mercury, lead, silver, gold, copper, which are not only environmentally unfriendly, but have value in commodity markets. The landfill is not alone in this endeavor, as state legislation calls for shared responsibility among manufacturers, retailers, consumers, and the state. Most manufacturers, if they accept takebacks, usually offer online return opportunities. And locally, there are both retailers and private companies that accept various types of electronics for recycling. On our website, there is more information about those programs that are available right now. Adding electronics and televisions to our already extensive list of recyclables is a milestone that could have not been accomplished, without the vision and continuing support of the county commissioners. I'm pleased to mention that the ban on landfilling corrugated cardboard by the Alamance County Board of Commissioners implemented in 1989 was one of the very first in the country. And thank you again for this opportunity to share the update. And one last thing. I'd like to announce that we've set a date for our annual paint and pesticide collection day. It'll be October 17th at the Burlington Fire Training Center in Hall River. We've actually changed the collection hours this year. It'll be from 8 to 1 instead of 9 to 2 like it was last year. And I'll be glad to respond to any questions or comments concerning the new electronics recycling program or our paint and pesticide collection. Yes, ma'am.
I do have a statement, question, or whatever you want to put it.
Sure.
I think it was within the last week or so, it was on 20 minutes.
60 minutes.
60 yes. minutes.
Yes.
Whatever. Let's say 30. 60 minutes about where these recyclables and these heavy metals and et cetera, where they're going.
Mm-hmm.
Are we shipping them out to third world countries where they're causing much problems?
Right. CRS, Creative Recycling Systems, processes all of the electronics here in North Carolina, meaning it all gets separated into essentially raw materials, metals, plastic, glass. It all gets separated. So we're not sending, if it does go overseas, which some of it does, because that's where the larger markets are, if it does, it's not in a form like you saw on 60 Minutes where it's whole computers that people are manually taking apart, which is where the toxicity comes from.
Yeah, so do we have that guarantee from CRS?
We do. They with the ISO 14001 certification, it doesn't guarantee that it doesn't go overseas, but it sets a standardization for how they process it. And that's also, they're on the term contract for the state, and the state did look into the vendors that they chose and how they process it and where it goes.
Did they check these computers for private information at all on them, or how
do they handle it? No, they shred all the hard drives.
They shred the hard drives, mm-hmm. Okay. Because I got one that came from Orange County, and I don't know what's on it, and I can't hook it up again. old. But I have no idea what's on it. So anyway, that's why I wondered about how they did that, if they mm-hmm. checked it to see if there's any.
No, they just go ahead and shred them.
Okay.
Madam Chair,
yes,
I'd like
sir.
To publicly thank Emily for having so this. She's been with us for a little over a year, and actually one this is one of the challenges that I actually put on her, and she's really ahead of the curve.
Yes.
So
yes,
I wanted to make mention of that. She's been really, really good for us.
Thank you, Emily.
Emily, how often do they pick up the equipment, and are we looking at space, more space there for doing, you know, buildings? I noticed everything looked like it was under shelters.
There. Right. We, since we just started, we're trying to figure out right now our shipment cycle, right, because we just had another shipment this morning, but it wasn't a tractor trailer. It was a smaller truck, which we could have used a tractor trailer this morning. So we're still trying to work on the
figure that out,
and hopefully in the first 3 to 4 months we'll really.
But you do have the building space. It looks like mm-hmm. everything is pretty much under.
Yes, sir.
All right, Emily, they pick up, but with these metals that are in there, such as gold and copper and copper and copper and gold and silver, are we getting anything back here in the county from that?
No, because what they're doing, we don't pay any money as long as 50% or less of the shipment is our televisions, because televisions cost more to process. So normally they would charge somebody, a municipality, to take those and process them. But because they're getting the money from all the other things, they're not going to charge us for the televisions.
Now, are there fees imposed to put these in here? What are the, to the person that brings it?
There are normal tipping fees that do apply because we do have processing.
Okay. Yeah. So it's
that we do. Right.
Normal fees. Yeah.
Yes.
I got okay. So. Good Any job. More questions for Ms. Emily? Okay, thank you so much. Okay. County Manager report?
Excuse me, just a couple of things this evening. Just to let you know, we found out last Wednesday that we did get approval from the Local Government Commission for our Phase 1 projects for our $3.5 million loan. So we do have that approval, and we are looking at closing the loans on September 24th. And then after that, hopefully we can see construction and some changes going on within 30 days after that. So the capital projects are moving forward. If there are any questions. Next is an update on the county line issue. Again, want to thank Commissioner Boswell and Commissioner Vaughn for attending the meeting with Orange County. The Mevins Arts Center that Orange County did set up, and we did kind of find out about that as a last-minute meeting. But we did appreciate your attending, and also Bruce Walker did attend as well. So hopefully this is moving forward. Now we have a meeting right now scheduled between staffs of Orange County and Alamance County to go over some of the input that was received and kind of work on next steps and to make look at some recommendations to give both boards for the joint meeting. So the process is moving forward, but we do not have a date set yet for that joint meeting. Any questions on that?
Will that joint meeting be during the day or at night or afternoon?
Whatever the wishes of the board. We'll try to accommodate everybody's schedule.
Do a week's notice.
We'll give you some dates to choose from on that. And speaking of joint meetings, just a reminder, our joint meeting with the school board is on September 17th at 8 a.m. At the school board's central office. That's where we'll be discussing the stimulus money, some leftover bond money, and their plans for some capital expenditures and projects that would have to be approved by the board. And on a good note, I do want to give a special thank you and an attaboy to three guys in our recreation department, Ron Boggs, Lamont Stokes, and Ronald Graves. We got a note from the seniors at the seniors bingo group at Eli Whitney, who just really wanted to comment on what a wonderful job staff did, how much fun they had, how well it was run. But I'll make sure that the board has a copy of this. But I just wanted to publicly thank Brian and his group for that. Where's Brian? That there. And that's all I have at this point.
Okay. Next is our consent agenda. Is there anything on here that we want to take off at this time and talk about?
Yeah.
All right, Ann. What do you want to take off?
Let's take B2.
B2?
Yeah.
Okay, that's the sheriff's.
It's just for clarification.
I thought we had decided that we were going to have all the budget
amendments. That was my next question, too.
In
you mentioned that regular, last time. Yeah.
Well, I don't think we voted on that. Did we?
Well, it was a request, and I think maybe we do need to vote on it, but money issues
are important enough to be discussed.
Best of my memory, the previous board, when Bill was on here, Bill, you made that motion, right?
Yeah.
I believe, and it was approved. And then when the new board took
we don't over, know anything about it.
Yeah,
unless it was voted on not to do it, it should be done.
We changed it.
That's right.
We changed it back to where it's on consent agenda.
Ready.
I remember that. Yeah. Prove it.
Yeah, it's true. But I remember it too.
Can we check on that and see what that deal is?
Money matters should not be
to find out about it.
And before you get started, I'd like to mention one other thing, too, as far as consent agenda is concerned. When we set these public hearings, I'm going to ask that they not be in the consent agenda. The general public does not know what's in the consent agenda, and they don't know about these public hearings ahead of time, and it's not right. If we're going to be open, let's just have the announcement that the public hearing is somewhere else besides in the consent agenda. Will you guys agree to that?
I agree with that.
I don't know. Are you saying
that's,
the
yeah, like D there to pull that out that we're setting for the CDBG?
And just put list it as an item, instead of in the consent agenda.
That's fine.
I don't have problem. Whatever.
Okay, Mr. Sheriff.
All right.
Hold on a second.
Okay. Okay, yeah.
Wait a minute. She's not ready.
I haven't found
10B2.
I'm looking. Okay. I got it. I got it.
Okay. I know you agree with training, and so do I, of course. You're moving $5,000 from one of your forfeiture funds.
Moving 5,000.
But it leaves $719.96. Where will that come from? Don't say budget. Say whose budget. You're moving $5,000 out of one of your forfeiture accounts to cover this, but that leaves for the total cost $719.96. Where will that come from?
It will come from our training budget. What we did, has happened is that if you remember, the commissioners removed a line item for out-of-state training travel. And we have a $10,000 out-of-state travel, but it's for investigations, et cetera, not for training. So the school that we're trying to get these deputies in is in El Paso, Texas. It's a drug smuggling, human smuggling training. Recently, within the last 3 months, there's been over $7 million seized between here and El Paso, Texas, where cartels are running money and drugs into Alamance County, and our people will be working with the Border Patrol down there in this school, learning the cartels and different things and how it's being done. And the $5,000 is from our federal vice, previously seized drug money, not taxpayer money.
Seized. I had mentioned before, and that's not just for your department, but any departments that's going on these training trips, that can they be videotaped? In other words, I know we're in bad economic times, and I know, you know, Alamance County is not as bad as some, but if we can hold on to some of our dollars, whether it's for training or whatever it is, and I'm not saying just your department,
I understand.
Can they be videotaped and brought back?
And they, on this particular school, this is actually working with the feds.
On the job training.
On the borders. And, you know, you can't run around possibly getting shot with a camera. It's just a lot of, I'm just saying a lot of things in this particular training that you're not going to be able to videotape.
Well, it's very interesting. Good reading.
Well, thank you. We feel it's imperative that our officers receive training down there, because what's coming in and going out of Alamance County right now is going to be directly related to probably the individuals that they're going to be working and training on down in El Paso.
It's getting worse.
It is. Juarez is getting totally violent on the border, and we see that some of those individuals are making their way into Alamance County.
So we'll put that back on there.
Back
at this point. Any other things that anybody's got a question with on the consent agenda?
Well, maybe you want to mention that we are going to have a public hearing set for Ann there.
Well, let's do it under comments at the end.
Okay.
That, you know, we and this have it there.
That's fine. Okay. So please, we'll put it back on, and do I please hear a motion to accept the consent agenda?
Move. Motion. Make a motion. We do.
Have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. No opposed.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. The next thing is the commissioner's comments. And Ms. Vaughn, I'll start with you.
Yeah, I'll just repeat and repeat. Any public hearing, do this in two parts, Bill. Any public hearing needs to be out of the consent agenda and be put in the regular line items that we have on here. That's mainly for the public to know when there is a public hearing, because they don't know. To set a public hearing. Yeah. That's right.
That's fine.
Do I need to make that?
Because the public hearing is on here.
Right. But see,
yeah.
To set a public hearing.
It's notification.
To set a public hearing.
To set a public hearing. And I'm making that in the form of a motion.
Okay. I have a motion that we add that to our agenda. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Okay. On Thursday, aye.
Aye.
No opposed? Okay. That's fine. No problem.
Okay. Now, to follow up with that, all money matters. If we're going to have to make that a motion again. All money matters, whether it's budget changes or so forth.
I've asked for them to look that up, because if it's already been done, then it's we been don't done. Have to do anything. So I've asked them to look it up and verify that was done. Can you see if you can do that, Pat? And that way we won't have to worry about it, okay?
It'd be easier just to make a motion.
It'll probably be easier to make a motion rather than look up to all that. Because it was done years ago, and it's probably been 10 years ago.
No wonder we don't know about it.
Thomas says 2005, Bill.
Says 2005.
Three of us remember.
Yeah, he probably knows.
Thomas says 2005.
Then I'm going to make a motion.
Yeah.
Whoever.
Okay. Bill, you want to make this motion?
I'll make the motion. Include any money matters, take it out of the consent agenda, and add it to
it. And put it on line item.
All right, I have a motion. Do I hear a second?
Including raises. Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Including raises.
Do I have a second?
I second it.
Okay. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed. Okay. No problem. All right. Next, any more commissioner comments?
I've got a couple of things I'd like to talk about real briefly. The first item it came out in our manager's report this past weekend that y'all were going to come to us with some plan as to what the meeting space would be at the courthouse. Okay. I'd just like to comment a little bit about that situation. You know, I don't have a problem being outvoted, or I may even support it going to the courthouse. But the process, in my opinion, of how this has transpired, in my opinion, it has just been not to my liking. The night that you stood behind the podium and you were talking about refurbishing the courthouse, and there was a just, and I don't mean this disrespectful at all, but there was just a flippant kind of a nod toward the courthouse and a smile that, well, if you know, we could have our commissioner meetings out there if y'all wanted to. And I know I didn't make a single comment. There certainly wasn't a vote. And I think somebody did say something, but it was you couldn't hear it on a DVD of the meeting. And from that, it appears that everybody took that to just run with it. And I've had some phone calls that I felt like were very robotic in the sense that there was no there's just been no discussion. It's you know, it was almost like it was a done deal, and that's what everybody wanted to do. Again, if I'm outvoted on it or if I vote to support it, fine. I just don't believe we did. I don't believe we had any reasonable discussion about moving a meeting, our meeting place. I've sat in this seat 15 years and haven't seen a dramatic situation as far as attendance that we have to accommodate. I don't know which is worse, frankly, opening up that other room over there or having to go up to the courthouse twice a month and heat it, cool it, staff it, take it apart, put it together. So, again, I haven't been pleased at all with the way that's been handled, number one. And, again, the phone calls to me or with me, I think, have just been very, very robotic, and I just don't appreciate that at all. And number two, when you come to us with the design of how we're going to do this, I would like to see a cost analysis, a pro forma done of what it's going to take to completely move everything up there, including the cameras, the furniture, the table, the dice, whatever we're going to be sitting at, and number one. And number two, I'd like to see the figures that we spent on this room recently with new carpet, new wallpaper, and so forth and so on, how much that's cost. And then thirdly, I'd like to see what we're planning on doing now in with this room. I was told in one of the phone calls that I had with management that this would be turned into office space. Well, if that's the case, I'd like to see what that seat of the britches call would be on the dollars of doing that. Because it all, from A to Z, is going to come to a dollar sign of not doing anything versus doing that. And I'd like to see those numbers before we finally, you know, say yes or no. I would. So, but I don't think I've had any of that nor gotten any of that. And I think that's only good sense to ask those questions.
And that was one of the reasons why I did put it in the update, is because we are getting to the point of having those more detailed discussions. And that was something that, since I've been here, we have not had really a clear direction from the board. And that's the reason why I put it on there. If there did need to be further discussion, what this board needed, to let me know, and we will get that information for you.
Well, again, I like to see A to Z, pre-cost, after-cost, post-cost, and so forth. In other words, what we've done to this room, carpet, wallpaper, and it's just been done within the last 12 months.
Yes, sir.
And then to turn around and move everything up there, new stuff, and after we're out of here, what's going to cost post move to renovate this into office space? Because all that is, a cost that you're either going to incur if you do move, or a cost that you won't incur if you don't move.
Right. Yes, sir.
My second situation, if Mr. Bass, if I could ask you a couple questions, please, if you don't mind. To ask you a question about some old business, over at the health department, we had this controversy quite a while ago about identities as far as excuses, work excuses versus their real identity. How is that being handled today? Are there any instances of somebody under one name at the health department getting an excuse for whatever reason to go back to their...
Not to my knowledge.
Not to your knowledge at all.
That's correct.
Okay.
Not that I'm aware of.
All right.
And one of the other things, too, that you may or may not know, is that we will be involved in what's called the red flag rules, which we do identities on folks when they come through our department. We also have pictures made of all of our patients, including myself when I was in when I came on board, they took pictures of us, so that's in the medical record to make sure that we're, as best we're able to look at that medical record and make sure that it's the same person that we have on file.
Okay, good. And I hope all this is taken with due respect, and it's just, you know, when you're in government and there's checks and balances and these trying times, I mean, people have to ask questions, and maybe they're redundant to some people, maybe they're politically charged, and people, you know, can accuse somebody for all kind of reasoning as to why they do something. But I'm doing this from my heart, and I'm doing this with really a heavy heart, too, because I hate to have to ask questions all the time, but it's part of what this is all about. It's not easy, but when I met you years ago, or a couple years ago, out here on the sidewalk, you and I talked, and I pleaded with you at that time, I think, in a very diplomatic manner that I hope that, you know, our health department, as with any department, would do its job. But if it saw something that the government leaders were asking for that might show cause and effect, I mean, it's one thing to constantly address the effects, but not to address the causes and tell somebody what they think the causes are, in my opinion, it's just going to take on more water and sink even further. So, you know, I ask that, you know, you please always shoot straight with me and so forth. I'm not saying you haven't, but and I still plead that. When I asked when this swine flu situation came about, and I asked for statistics on the ethnic background of who had the flu, I didn't ask for names, I didn't ask for addresses. I just asked a legitimate question that is, in my opinion, government records have. And you and I talked, well, I don't believe you talked, I think county manager talked with you about it, and we got into sort of this stalemate as to, well, I don't have the stats, or I'm not permitted to give them, or whatever, whatever. And I call Raleigh, and Raleigh tells me they don't know why you can't give me this information. And then in the minutes of the meeting that you had on June 16th, the board meeting, you state that you called and asked the same question but did not get a direct response. Did you pin them down? I had to pin them down. I got some rhetoric when I asked the question, and I had to just ask again, point blank, you know, am I not allowed to have this information? That's when she answered yes. You know, I don't see why they can't give it to you. Did you pin her down or whoever you talked to?
Well, in the discussion that we had, and I think I'd actually given you an email response, that in looking statistically, and the issue goes back to, as you all know, that we no longer keep any records of numbers of cases, per se, as we did at the outset. And the issue came up about the small number of cases that we had. And there is a way, statistically, as it was explained to me, that you could get a statistician to be able to de-sanitize the information to where you could abstract that. I don't know how you do that with 12 cases. But because of your inquiry, the state has subsequently given us percentages of ethnicity when they've given out data. For example, the last time, I think it was like 2 weeks ago, 50% of the cases at that time were African American, and roughly 25% are Hispanic, 20% are Caucasian, and the other 5% are other.
And that's statewide.
Yes, sir. That's statewide. Mm-hmm. So that's the best. And prior to your inquiry, those numbers were never vetted. Period. Mm-hmm. So.
But we can't get that for Alamance County. You're saying? Are you still saying that?
There is a way, if we could talk to a statistician. In my conversation with the folks in Raleigh, they said, but because of the small number of cases that we were dealing with at that time, it would have been very difficult to do that.
Now, in your minutes, you state that Mr. Bass asked the Board of Health if they are comfortable waiting to hear from the state's legal department on this or if he should share the information. Now, forgive me, but I find that somewhat in conflict. How could you share it with me if you were claiming you didn't have it or so forth?
Well, subsequently, I mean, I don't know that, personally don't know what the information would look like, and especially now because we don't keep case records of the number of cases.
Well, forgive me, I don't understand how you can share it with me. You're asking them, can you share it with me? Did the state legal department ever give you a ruling on this?
Basically, they said it was because of the small numbers, it was a HIPAA issue. To my recollection, was the response that I got back. Because, again, it was due to the small number of cases that were here at the time. But in terms of if I have or known what the actual number of those cases were and how that broke down, I do not know that.
How's the state have it?
Well, that may be how it's reported. I mean, I've not personally looked at it.
There was a document that you emailed that stated, and I left it. I thought I had everything on this, and I'm almost through. But there was a decision out of Chapel Hill Institute of Government that was saying you can't release certain things if certain things are. I can't think of.
Well, no, this, and that's the email that I was referring back to yesterday.
But down at the bottom, there's an option two for you know, to look
and
at.
And that's the part about if there was some way that you could
release it without identifying the person.
It's a de-identification process.
Exactly.
It's a statistical way.
DIP.
That she, okay, and talking to the attorney said that, I don't know how you do that. You have to get a statistician to do this.
Yeah. But it clearly said, well, frankly, I like the way they had a little blank in there where they could insert their own couple of sentences on the computer. You know, it's nice to be able to change everything or adapt everything or add to everything. But it said clearly if it was reasonable that the information could be given without identifying the people, you know, that you could do that, but that would be a decision y'all would have to make. Without, you know, going a whole lot further on that, the in the packet that we got, you had a new, or you had a, what was it? Policy on confidentiality and release of medical records that was approved. Is that correct?
That was the policy that I think you're referring to is one that we're going to look at again.
Okay. Is that, do you not have one in place now?
We do have one in place, but according to some of the concerns they raised, we may have some issues with how we maintain some of the records. And we just wanted to review it. Not that we would make any changes, but to go back and have a review. Okay. That was part of what we were going to do with our personal health committee meeting next week.
Okay. Could I see the old one? Could you get me a copy of the old one?
I think that the one you
got. Or is this not the new one?
That is the current one, so that is the old one.
Oh, okay, so you're going to look at this one.
That's the one we're going to look at, yes, sir. Okay.
All right.
And no decision, the committee's not met or anything, just to make sure that everything that we have is copacetic.
Well, forgive me, but it just seems like, you know, that you've got the figures, yet you don't have them. You can give them, but you can't give them. And again, you know, I don't see anything wrong with asking the question and getting the answer. And it's one thing to have, cause and effect for you to address the effects, but for you to sit back and think, well, maybe the legislators, you know, can't do anything to help improve the causes and lessen the effects and so forth. I think that's... We have to have a better exchange, in my opinion, of information. And let me ask you, on your stats now, why are the stats so glaring in these categories statewide, do you think?
In terms of, I think it's very typical of what we call health disparities, that minority groups tend to be more adversely affected for whatever reason in these situations. That's just my personal opinion, but I think most person, you know, if you look at most public health, that minorities tend to have the worst outcomes. And so this would be another case of that. If we're looking, you know, we're looking across North Carolina and you got 50% of the folks who are being adversely affected, that's not, unfortunately, is not atypical.
Well, what I found to be ironic, I'm through, is that you could tell me the percentage of people in all the ethnic backgrounds that had AIDS or other diseases, but you couldn't tell me the swine flu. And I find that to be either contradictory or there's something wrong there. And I hope that we can get these stats in the future if I ask for them. Because I'm going to keep asking. Okay.
Fair enough.
HIPAA has a lot to do with what you can give out, because I know that I was a medical record supervisor, and I knew what I could and could not give out.
It was particularly in effect when we had a very small number of cases when the time that question was asked.
So I do understand all that.
There's many ways to interpret all that, too.
Okay, any announcements from anybody? We are adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.